Big question is this. The Green Rush was a $10 billion industry last year. Experts say it's going to be worth over $20 billion by the end of next year. How do normal people like us, who didn't cheat by being born into the 1%, how do we use the money from our own pockets and participate in this massive wealth creation event while building financial freedom for ourselves and generational wealth for our families? That is the question. My name is Charles. Join me
as we explore these answers.
To start, so we're kind of on Rev 2. So right now, I'm super excited to talk about this. And just for everyone who's there, I'm just excited because I always love talking about investing. And I've always am excited about talking about how we can invest and make a lot of money. And what really gets me excited is we're kind of at a stage in the market where we've never seen an opportunities like what we see today in front of us. And what I'm talking about is stuff that is bigger and better than a lot of things that are out there on the market. So I've actually, today, I am rehearsing a class that we're going to be producing. So I've actually even prepared some slides. And what I first want to start with is, you know, a little bit about ourselves and everything like that. But more importantly, we want to talk about, you know, what's wealth. And I'd love to get your opinion, Courtney. You know, how do you define wealth? I mean, I know a lot of people define wealth differently. Do you have any thoughts on this? Or, you know, what makes you wealth? Is it happiness? Is it health?
I think it's a combination of all those things. It's happiness, it's wealth, it's the ability. I think it kind of all encapsulates together. It's the ability to do what you want when you want. And I think that kind of does a marriage of between money and health and kind of just opportunity. When you don't have your health, you can't just go anywhere because you have to worry about your health. Same thing if you don't have money, you can't just do whatever you want because you're limited by the funds that you have. So it's kind of all of those things together is what I consider to be wealth.
Definitely. No, that's a great definition. And I know for a lot of people out there, and if anyone who's on, you know, feel free to comment, let us know what you think. You know, there's many ways of looking at it. Some people say it's happiness. Some people say it's peace of mind. Ultimately, there's many different ways. I like to look at it from a perspective of net worth, you know, and it's not a matter of how much the net worth, but we all have, if I were to say, that number in our mind that gives us that freedom, right? That health, that happiness, and that wellness on that side. And the key to remember, the way I look at it, is it's different for every circumstance. For some people, and I don't know what your thoughts are, but, you know, buying a house means I'm wealthy. For other people, it's just paying off debt. For others, it could be not having to work again. I mean, what do you think? You know, what for you is freedom and wealth, Courtney? Like, do you want to not work? Go sit on a warm beach? What are your thoughts on that?
I think biggest thing is that wealth looks like to me is opportunity. So I think one, I don't talk about debt this way all of the time, but sometimes I think that can be very limiting, almost like a noose around your neck, kind of like chains on your ankles, or basically kind of forcing you to be somewhere or do something that you don't want to do. So I think that's where kind of debt finds a lot of us. So being debt free, so kind of basically paying off debt, but then on the other side, not having to work again is a big deal also. So being debt free on one side, but then also not having to, you know, do a 9-to-5, but also doing what I love. There are certain things that I love to do. And I'm like, okay, I can do this even if I didn't get paid. But I think those are the things that I think about when I think about being wealthy. It's not having to work and then also having no debt.
Well, so that's an interesting one. And let's discuss this a little bit because there's that term, right? Good debt and bad debt. So you could be, well, you could actually not have to work again if you had the right kind of debt. Maybe you have real estate, cash flow, properties. And in some cases, if you don't, what do you think, right? Should you pay off everything or would it be better to actually have a little bit of debt and enhance that cash flow and basically put your money to work? Right or wrong answer.
Let me, I actually should clarify that. What I mean by being debt-free, I mean consumer debt. Like, I mean, like credit cards. I mean, anything that's a, what I would consider credit cards or a car or something like that, depreciating asset. I can't get anything from that. Kind of, I've already spent the money on the credit card. I've already, you know, basically spent the money on the car, and the car over time depreciates over time, unless the value does, unless it's some kind of special, fancy, whatever car. I mean, so it's kind of those types of things. When I'm looking at non-consumer debt, when I'm looking at business debt or investing debt, to put in a different terms, that's completely different. So if I have multiple mortgages on a property, if I'm doing BRRRR, which is, you know, buy, you know, rent, buy, rehab, rent, refinance, when I'm looking at that and then repeat, then that's a different kind of debt, because, you know, I'm using the refinance to actually leverage to get into another property. So that's a different type of debt.
And for everyone who's out there that doesn't know, Courtney is actually a very knowledgeable real estate attorney. So you know the ins and outs, I'm sure, about all that sort of stuff and how people go about doing this and everything on that side. Yeah. Now, just about me, I guess, you know, personally, I look at, you know, for me, wealth is I want to take profits that I have and I want to put them into cash flowing assets that would eventually replace my income. And for me, wealth is getting to that point where I have enough cash flowing assets, in my case, real estate, that lets me live off my day-to-day income expenses. And then everything else is icing on the cake, and I can go do whatever I want or explore different ideas or do everything on that. And the reason why this is important is, I'll tell you a personal story on my end. In my case, it was around probably 10 years ago when I actually hit that spot. But it's not like I hit that spot, you know, and it wasn't dependent on how much money or income I was making. What was key to me actually was understanding, you know, the concept of money. And for me, you know, I had my, what's called my aha money moment when I realized, hey, I can work and I can work hard and I can bust my butt and everything, and I can go make more money. But the amount of money that I'm making on an active side doesn't correlate with my passive income or my investments and my feelings of freedom that I have. I don't know if you've had that impression before or anything. You know, I'm at an age where I've had some major ups and I've had some down years, and it's life, right?
Right. No, I completely agree. And I think you make a very valid point about active versus investing income or passive income. Once I really understood the tax code, and I understood that if I worked for my money, I paid more taxes, that was my aha moment. So my function was to move as much as my earned income into passive income streams, so I was going to get taxed less on the gains that I had from those passive income streams. So that was my aha moment. I was like, oh no, I don't want to work because you're going to tax me more. Because if I have capital gains, my long-term capital gains, I'm going to be taxed significantly less, in some cases 20% less. And that's more money in my pocket.
Wow. Now I'm curious to ask you a question, because for people who don't know, Courtney, your mission, or you spend a lot of time on educating people, and specifically educating people on money. So money is one of those topics, it's a little taboo, isn't it? Or, I mean, you run into this more than I do, right, on that front. So what do people run into when you start talking to them about money? Is it a bad thing? Do they tell you to shut up? Do they just look at you funny?
I think it's the kind of the blank stare. It's kind of the clamming up. And it's not necessarily that it's a sense of embarrassment. A lot of people are kind of like, I don't want you to judge me by my poor money management decisions, or things like that. And I kind of get that, but the way I combat that is I talk about my own money management and my own problems that I've had, even, you know, quote unquote, knowing better. I was licensed as a financial advisor in 2003. But if you know me personally, I almost was not admitted to the bar in 2013 because of my credit. So again, years later, you're kind of going, oh, doesn't she know better? And I mean, of course I did. Now, I was laid off in 2009 as a financial advisor working for Merrill Lynch because, you know, the market crashed in 2008. and Merrill Lynch was purchased by Bank of America. So it kind of changed, and I went to law school. So kind of those things, those dynamics did change. And one of the things that I learned is that you have to learn how to adjust your income. If you do downsize, you have to downsize everything. So I give you that story to say, once I share those stories and I share my experience and working through that and getting out of that, and, you know, getting to well over a 700 credit score from being there, from being almost denied not to practice in the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania to getting well over a 700 credit score, people kind of relate to you differently and better.
You know, it's great that you brought that up, and I want to thank you for actually being honest and showing vulnerability, because a lot of people, I think, we are afraid to talk about money because there's a level of shame. And I mean, I can only speak for myself. I remember, you know, for people who've tuned in, what we're talking about is, you know, how to invest $1,000 and hopefully turn it into $1 million and create generational wealth. The first step that I had to learn was I had to not be afraid to use money as a tool and recognize. And the key here is that money, it's a tool, and done right, used right, the tool can be great. Used wrongly, it can be really, I mean, let's put it bluntly, it can be a mess. Yeah. I mean, in my side, I have had ups and downs. There was a point, and this was around 2007, where, I don't know if you know this, but, you know, I started my first business in college. So I was 19. At the age of 25, I was on the Inc. 500. So, you know, the business was doing over $10 million a year. And, you know, life was good, right? I'm making money. And, I mean, I'm not in any way, you know, like that sports star or anything like that, but I probably spent pretty poorly. And literally, if you could imagine, I was 27 or 28, and we had a house in the suburbs that was probably, you know, 2 acres of property, 7,000 square feet. I had a 3-story condo in the city and everything like that. So like, I had a pretty big monthly nut to cover, right? And then 2007, 2008 hits, and I lost $1 million that year. Wow. So not only is it like, oh my gosh, I'm not making money, but then it comes down and I was in a bad spot where literally it's not like, you know, it's one thing if it's just, oh, I can cut expenses and, you know, I just have to tighten my belt. But when you've got mortgages, when you've got liabilities and stuff like that, you just can't get it. It's not that easy to get out. Right. And I mean, it's tough to say it because no one wants to admit, especially when you're, you know, the people think you're making money or the company's doing well, or, you know, your friends think you're, you know, in this nice place or you're driving that nice car. It's really hard to say, oh my gosh, you know, you look at your checking account or you say, oh my gosh, where's that money coming in next month? Because I've got to cover this and this and all that sort of stuff. But what I wanted to state was, you know, for both of us, we've all had our ups and downs. It's really realizing that money is a tool, and like all tools, whether it's, you know, a knife, right? I could use a knife for good things. I can cut food with my knife or whatnot, right? Or I could stab someone with a knife. That could be used for a bad thing. You know, fire is another thing, right? You know, fire is what created mankind. On the other hand, fire can burn things down, or fire can, you know, like everything can be used good or bad, right? Protein's the other thing. I love eating healthy proteins, or I love eating my fish. I love eating my steak, but I could eat too much and get cholesterol. And the key here of what I found is with money used properly, right? It makes something beautiful, but used wrong, it makes a mess. And more importantly, though, is I think what people need to understand, or what I've learned, and I'd love to get your feedback on this, is for me, my big aha moment first was something bad happened. So I had to figure out how money was. But then the second aha moment was realizing that money is not a physical good. And I'd be curious, you know, if people are watching, if you want to comment or ask questions, if you need more clarification. What I found was money's almost, it's like energy. Like, I don't know if that makes any sense, but it doesn't just, it's not there. It's not like a gold. It's not an asset. It doesn't disappear. It just transfers. Does that make any sense to you, no, Courtney? Or?
Definitely. I mean, it's essential is I work, you know, 3 hours and I get paid $1,000. So the person I work for, the entity I work for, they pull their $1,000 and give it to me. It doesn't just kind of pop out of nowhere. And then again, and then I turn around and take my $1,000 and I invest it, or I spend it, or I do a combination of both. But again, it's going somewhere. It's being recycled.
Exactly.
So no, definitely, I agree.
And the key here is to realize, just like how we said, it's a tool, it's energy, that energy can be transferred into good things. Maybe I can transfer that money into investments that then earn more money for me, that work for me, or I can transfer that into bad things. You know, like one of the bad things I bought, and, you know, in hindsight, we all look back and we laugh. When I was 28, I bought a really nice BMW. You know, so I've got my $80,000 car, but, you know, I didn't pay cash for it. And what I had was, that was $1,500 a month, you know, that you got to pay for the thing. And then the thing to realize too is, when you transfer your money in the bad spot, it wasn't just the car payment. Well, now you got to pay to get it cleaned. You got to park it in a nice place. You can't just park it on the street in the city. You got to valet it, and, you know, like everything, you know, that's just how it is. And the key, though, I think for a lot of people, and what I realized was, when I realized that money was just like energy, there's a giving side and there's a receiving side. And the key to really understanding, at least for me, how to use my money, how the money flows, is we want to be on the receiving side of money. And more importantly, how do we be on the receiving side? Well, the starting point is to be on the receiving side, we want to invest. But more importantly, it's we want to be on the right side of the wealth transfers. And I know a lot of people who've tuned in the past, you realize that, hey, you know, I love to talk history. And right now, you know, we'll talk about the different points of wealth transfer. But the key to be mindful of is, realize, if you realize that money's like energy, if you're on the receiving side of it, you then just have to be positioning yourself to be on the right side of receiving that money. Now, some people, I don't know if you've ever had that experience. You know, some people, they say, well, I had a bad experience once, so I'm just going to close my eyes, shut my mouth. You know, I just want to sit out altogether. I don't know if have you met people like that, or have you ever been in that way? Or
I have. I've seen it a lot, and it really stinks. It's like, hey, I've gotten burned before. I'm never going to touch fire. But yeah, you got burned before because you weren't using the tool properly. But the problem is that you need fire to live. So now you've kind of cut off a life source, or, I mean, let's bring it down. You're just basically cutting off your nose to spite your face, because yes, you did have a bad experience, but you have to learn from the experience for that not to happen again, or else you end up cutting yourself off from a good experience and basically making more money. And I've seen that just happen all the time. They're like, someone's like, hey, I was investing in the stock market and I lost a lot of money. I'm never going to do that again. So I'm going to put my money in the bank. And I'm like, okay, so you're going to lose money because the bank doesn't keep up with inflation. So the $1,000 you put in the bank today is going to be worth less, even with the quote interest you get. It's going to be worth less in terms of buying power 5 years from now. So you're going to say, hey, I had this bad experience in the stock market, instead of saying, what did I do to get myself a bad experience in the stock market? How can I fix that? You just stay away from it completely. So then you end up going to something that's inferior, and then you end up losing.
Oh, definitely. Actually, we've got a comment from Chase. Chase is saying, you know, think about it. Money is a piece of paper on a receipt. So we want to use money to create more money. And he's done by using money just to impress people.
Oh yeah,
I think that's great. I mean, that's a great comment from somebody. And speaking of which, let's talk about the stock market, right? So we're here to talk about how to invest money and turn it into more. Well, step one is you've got to play the game.
Right.
So we got to be in the market, and this is the S&P. And it's what you said, right? If I've just been in the S&P, and even though there's been ups and downs and everything, over the last 3 years, the S&P's still done pretty well on that front. I think we're up almost, you know, last year it was up 20% and everything. And it's important for everyone who's listening, it's important to invest in your financial education, which is why, if you're still listening in, why you're here. And what you'll find a lot of times is, in life, if you just kind of shift how you look at things. Like, I'm not looking at the market, oh my gosh, I'm down 5% today, or I'm down 2% tomorrow, or I'm up 5%. and I'm rich or I'm poor, if you're able to step back and, I guess, what, look at the forest instead of the trees, that will really help in building wealth. Now, moving forward, the question is, you know, 20% or the S&P 500 is good, but more importantly, we want to look at, you know, how do we actually invest $1,000 and turn it into much bigger dollars, you know, maybe hundreds of thousands or even millions, so that we can create generational wealth. So I'm a big believer in history. And this is a quote, you know, history doesn't repeat itself, but it does rhyme. And I would love to get your opinion. But what I have found, and the way I have found to be the most successful way for me to invest, whether I'm investing my time or I'm investing my dollars or everything on cents, is catching those innovation cycles. Mm-hmm. So if we look at history and everything, right, you know, innovation cycles, there were the railroads, there were automobiles, there were computers, there was then the rise of the mobile phone, there was the rise of the internet, and now there are new cycles that are starting. You know, that's kind of how I like to look at things. I'm not sure, you know, what your thoughts are on this, Courtney, if you are, you know, if you see these trends.
I definitely see the trends. I don't think I've ever looked at it that way in terms of innovation cycles, but definitely it's certainly on point. The definite way to look at things is that what was the old way of doing things and how have we changed it? So I'm looking at it. So we have the substitution. So like it's something stops working. And then what have we done to replace it? And that's kind of like how life works. I mean, you have a great thing with the railroads, the automobiles, then computers, mobile phones, and internet technology, how all of that kind of, especially railroads and automobiles, like how they replaced each other kind of in the way the United States has grown across the world. But then it's also interesting to see how railroads are kind of making their way back, but they're kind of coming back with the way we think about like air travel. So we have the bullet trains that go super fast on it, but it's still a train. So it's like looking at that innovation that way also. And then here's my question. What I like to do generally is I say, what enabled this change? What technology or what process was initiated for this change to actually happen? Sometimes that's technology, sometimes that's a policy, sometimes that's just kind of something being flipped on its head. Sometimes, I guess, nature.
No, I agree. And I think it's good to look at it, you know, when we talk about trends and cycles and everything, and we'll get into, for people who are in, kind of the bigger cycles that are coming on that we see. I think this is where that money is energy really ties in together from my perspective, right? So let's just think of energy and let's just talk about Uber, for example, right? Uber is a innovation cycle or an innovation shift in the taxi driving industry. So if you look at it, right, before Uber, the money was there and the money was in the taxi drivers and the money was in the taxi medallion, because if you had the medallion, you were then able to drive that taxi and everything. And you basically had a lock because there were a limited number of medallions out there and people had to wait in line. I think, I don't know, I'm kind of curious now that you bring that up, but like there was, I remember reading an article on taxi medallion pricing and you can see, let me see. Yeah, look at that, right? I don't know if you can see this, see my screen.
There we go.
A taxi medallion in New York in 2013 was $1 million. And as of 2018, that same medallion is now worth $200,000, right? And that, I mean, if you want to talk about innovation cycles or anything, a perfect example, what's the difference, right? You know, before the people with the money were the guys with the taxi medallions. And now what's happened is Uber has come in and Uber has taken almost that $800,000 in value per taxi medallion. And if we looked at, I mean, Uber's not public, so we can't look at that. But if you look at, call it the valuation of Uber, basically that money the money that was sitting in the value of the taxi medallion has now transferred over into the value of Uber as a company.
Right.
And I think this is the key for people who are looking to invest. I mean, you can definitely invest in the S&P, and ideally anyone who's investing, we highly recommend asset allocation. So don't, you know, put all your money in on red, right? That's a whole nother thing. But there's always a portion of the portfolio that we want to be able looking out for these trends. And if we can look at these trends and we can catch these trends, there's, you know, there's a lot of gravy to be made, and we can be on the receiving end of that. So I'd love to get your kind of opinion. Let's just talk about some trends. So, you know, you're an investor, you go by the IV investor. Now, people probably don't realize that the IV investor started before the current trend. But why don't you talk about, you know, some of the trends you're looking at, and let's just talk about the disruption and where you see the dollar shifting.
I really, and you know how I am about my law, is that I really try to follow where policy is going. So where policy moves, I move. I'm like, oh, policy is moving. Let's go with the policy, because again, that's kind of your, that's going to be pretty much what we'll I'll call your substitution, your where the money is going to start flowing. So we talked about last week when we talked about the hemp bill. The hemp bill has opened up hemp to be manufactured and I shouldn't say manufactured, but grown in the United States. I don't want to say freely because that's not quite right, but it's actually being able to be a real marketable crop in the United States with a little bit regulation, but still it's about looking where that money is going. So that's kind of where, like, I start with my trends. I look at my policies.
Yeah. I need this one, that one. I need her right there, her right there. Nowadays I got options. That it's in your face, hip hop hooray, hip hop all day. There is no piss stops, I'm on my way. Beautiful art, I mold them tracks like clay. House party kid, my time is not for play. I am making it, no faking it. I love my life, there is no replacing it. Still broke my dog, but I can taste the rich.
Hello everyone, this is a special edition of Beautiful Lady Seal. We are here in the heart of Ferguson at the beautiful Styltaneous Styles Boutique. But for me, it was, because what I had to recognize is there was some internal work, there was some internal things going on with me that I had to deal with before I was ready to present that work on the outside. So sit back and relax. This is behind the scenes of my makeover with Michelle the Artist right here on Dynasty Television.
The Save Our Neighborhoods Initiative, spearheaded by St. Louis City 21st Ward Alderman John Collins Muhammad and Mission Director Tori Russell, is focused on creating a better St. Louis by empowering its citizens in the communities they live through strategic cooperative economics, including urban farming, real estate development, and bringing businesses back into the neighborhood. We are making the 21st Ward a model for the entire metro area. Our program has launched through the $1 House Initiative, which allows citizens to affordably purchase and live in the safe and secure communities they help to create. We need your support to make this program sustainable. Contact Save Our Neighborhoods for more information and ways to get involved today at 314-532-5876. That's 314-532-5876. Or visit www.sonistl.com. Thank you.
Also, a couple of years ago, and I thought this was really, really interesting a couple of years ago, President Obama stated that he was, well, let me clarify, the DOJ said they were no longer using private prisons. And you're like, okay, that's wonderful. However, understanding policy is that in all private prison stocks that day, I think it was like summer 2016, they dropped astronomically about 65% in one trading day. And everybody, wow, that's the end of private prisons. I said, no. If you know anything about private prisons, and this is again, understanding policy, is that the main driver of private prisons on the federal level is ICE, which is Immigration and Customs Enforcement. So if you understood that, then you knew that it was a artificial drop. And so I help my mom with her retirement, and I have since she started her retirement. So I had a conversation with her. I said, how do you feel about this? And she's like, I'm not really jumping up and down about investing in private prisons, but if you do see an opportunity, I want you to get in. I don't want you to get out. So in about 4 months, and then also Trump was elected, so that did pop up this also.
So you're raking it in on the private prisons.
I did. And I got out. And I had to, because I just couldn't really get down, but I understood the market. And I understood that that there was kind of this artificial drop that happened in the market, and that sometimes you have to exploit it. But I didn't want to exploit people. So I was like, I'm not staying in long. And my mom was okay with that. And she's also, you know, retired. But she, at the time, she was retiring, or she just retired. So she was like, you know, let's try to get as much money as we can. But again, it's about, like I say, I followed policy, because that's where you're going to find those opportunities. Like, I just read everything and I'm like, oh, wait, that makes sense. Or, oh, that doesn't really follow. Let's see what more I can find out. So
that's brilliant to catch. I mean, because you're right. When everyone out there, I mean, everyone knows the private prison system. I mean, let's not even get started there, right? That's like investing in Monsanto.
Right.
I mean, exactly. You know, let's just, you know, destroy society. And I'm sure on your end, there's probably other ramifications in terms of how you feel about the prison system or your community, you know, friends and things like that. You know, that's a whole other mess. I'm not even going to touch that one, because that's just going to get me in trouble. But the fact that you saw that and then you realized that, oh my gosh, it's not just, okay, everyone hears the news and everyone's selling and they're like, oh, we got to go get out. But you're like, hold on, there's immigration. And prisons are more about immigration. And then did you predict that? Did you think that Trump would win, or were you feeling?
Actually, I did. I did. And the reason why, and let me tell you why, is that I was watching, on the Ivy Investor, I did a piece on Brexit, because remember, Brexit happened that summer.
You're right. And no one thought Brexit would happen. And it happened.
Exactly. But that's what I really was like, wait a second. I saw that same sentiment in the United States. And I was like, oh, this is not good. So I did see the possibility that Trump was going to win. And there was a guy, I forgot what his name is. He predicts presidential elections like almost to the.
Oh, yeah. I remember reading about that or hearing that. I think it was like he's like the presidential whisperer or whatever, right? You know, his seashells work perfectly.
Exactly. And he was predicting Trump. And I was like, this guy has never been wrong. I'm looking at Brexit. We thought Brexit was going to happen. And I heard the same sentiment. We were listening to the commentary of the British citizens about how they felt. And they felt like immigration and this is our place. And I was like, ooh, this sounds just like America. And I said, oh, this is not going to be good. So I definitely saw that that I felt like Trump was going to win. I didn't know that Trump was going to win. And then in turn, it was going to prop up stocks even more. But I also, we talked about how history does repeat itself. I did take a look at kind of, because I look at Trump like the Nixon administration, and I did look at some of the trends that were going on during that time. So I do see some real life parallels there. So I'm not a historian. I mean, I'm an attorney by trade, but you know, we kind of follow history because we talk about precedents or judicial precedent. So that's kind of what I look at also.
Wow. So now, I guess, I don't know if you're still in those prison stocks, but with this whole border wall stuff going on, I mean, now is that a good thing for that trend? Or I don't know anything about that. So
no, and I literally got out, I want to say February, it's either February or January of 17, I got out. Like, I just was just like, no, I'm out. I'm cool. I'm out. You know, I doubled my money. I over doubled my money and I just got out. I just, you know, because I'm not what I call myself a social investor, but I am not deaf to what goes on and how things operate. And I just cannot, I can't be okay with just making money off of something that I just conceptually don't agree with.
Yeah, no, I hear you. But still, I'm going to give, you know, everyone who's listening in, let's give like a mad heart or a like to Courtney. You know, doubled her money, you know, got in, got out, knew what she was doing. That's awesome. Now that is great. So let's actually dive in. You've developed a lot of expertise. Now, as the Ivy investor, obviously people think wink, wink. Haha, right? You know all about the good green stuff, but you've developed a lot of this expertise. So let's talk about, you know, what are the trends you see? Are there regulatory trends? Are there policy trends? You know, where is this disruption coming? Or let's just discuss it, because I've got some ideas, but I really want to hear your perspectives.
So I think I alluded to some of it earlier when I was talking about the Farm Bill. So let's talk about, I mean, we talked about it last week, but this gets me so excited. So before 2014, there was no legalized or legal way to grow hemp or marijuana in the United States. It just wasn't. I mean, as much as states were kind of allowing that, California has been in the medicinal marijuana game since 1996, but it wasn't necessarily what we would call federally legal. But in 2014, President Obama signed the Farm Bill, which allowed a pilot program of hemp. So industrial hemp, if people don't know, it's marijuana or cannabis. I should really be very clear here. It's cannabis with 0.3% of THC or less. That's what hemp is. And hemp is actually grown. It's a food stuff. I mean, you can make hemp oil, you can do whatever you do with it. But there's a lot of things that you can do with hemp. It's this fiber, but also you can get your, what we call medicinal CBD from, or we can get CBD, what everybody kind of gets really excited about. But now, in 2018, the Farm Bill actually legalized the ability for hemp to be grown legally. So what that causes, that's a policy change. So it basically allows hemp businesses to flourish. So I thought that was a really big thing on the policy side. In terms of, I mean, Canada kind of beat everybody to the punch. So I think Canada has to be mentioned here because they have been in the medical marijuana space since 2001. And then in 2018, they legalized recreational marijuana. They were the first kind of industrialized country, to do that. So you're like, okay, great. But what that's doing, it's kind of, so now you have these major players in Canada kind of trying to find their space in the United States. And what I'm starting to see companies that like were marijuana, well, cannabis companies overall, they had hemp and they were working on marijuana. They're starting to kind of section their businesses off and basically allow their hemp business to really flourish now that the policy allows them to do so. And now you're starting to see companies coming down, specifically Canopy Growth Company is coming down from Canada. And now they have set up shop in Southern New York on a hemp farm. So again, the biggest marijuana or cannabis company in the world has now come into New York to actually do business there. So that's really different. So again, it's that policy is driving business. So I think that's really what I'm seeing across the board. And I also think that policy that people are changing their mind about marijuana. They're changing their thoughts and what they feel is what marijuana is. So that's changing kind of how we look at it. And I think it's going to start pushing the policy for more legalization. I mean, we look at and kind of looking at history, talking about history doesn't repeat itself, but it rhymes. But we're also looking at, we talk about prohibition of alcohol and how that lasted for about 13 years. And now we have cannabis that is pretty much following the same prohibition path. And now we're starting to look at, it's basically been prohibitive directly since 1970. money, but kind of prohibitive measures were put in place in 1937. So we're looking at almost 70 years of just kind of like really hardcore prohibition against cannabis. So now we're starting to roll out of that. And that's where those companies are going to start really making moves. And you're going to start seeing that's where the money's being made. Because we can look at alcohol companies. More specifically, you look at, Constellation Brands. Constellation Brands has a huge stake in canopy growth. But Constellation Brands is doing amazingly, and they are a huge liquor manufacturer, the Corona. There's a couple of big names that they have. But again, that kind of liquor and all those vices kind of do really, really well in the market. So I love that you have this up, this general market S&P versus the Green Rush. Yeah.
Well, you know, that's the question. How do I take my $1,000 and turn it into a million? Now, like I said, if that's all you have, don't bet it all on the farm. Right. But the reality here is, right, you know, the first thing is you got to play the game, right? You've got to be in the S&P. You got to be in the market. Mm-hmm. But then when you look at it, if you can catch the trend, and well, there's a few things. First is, I like how you say what you said. I find I have to be emotionless. Because when the trend is out there and everyone's already talking about it, so like if you look at it, and what I've highlighted here, if you guys can see, this is Canopy Growth Corporation, the company you were talking about. This is probably the leader in the marijuana stocks. And we can literally see these bumps, right? This is beginning of 2018 when California legalized. This was, you know, this bump right here was probably, you know, beginning of 2017. Maybe there were some ballot initiatives. I don't remember, you know, what happened there. You know, this right here, this big bump here, that was the beginning when Canada legalized and the whole thing jumped. And I think the key to be mindful of, though, is when you've heard about this, like, it's already too late, right? So would you buy Canopy Growth? I'm not saying I wouldn't buy Canopy Growth. I mean, there probably is some long-term upside, but, you know, I mean, I think the valuation's a little bit on the high end. I probably wouldn't, you know, I think it's a little pricey. Mm-hmm. I'm looking for the next thing in terms like I want to be where the puck, I think that's a Wayne Gretzky quote, I think. I want to skate to where the puck's going to be. And when you're talking about this hemp and everything on that side, I mean, that's great, right? Hemp just got legalized, or it didn't get legalized, but there was a regulatory change. And I know, I mean, last time we were talking, you were telling me all the details. There's a lot of things I'm skipping over on that side, but there are some regulatory changes. And the question now is, where are we going on the hemp, you know, with hemp? What's the cycle going to? What's coming up next? You know, where's the disruption coming from? So why don't you, let's talk about that. Where do you think the major disruption points come from with hemp? Is it just CBD? Is there more to it? Is it, you know, let's chat.
I think it's going to be CBD. I think it's kind of going to be also the ancillary things as these programs and products become more mainstream. What's going to start happening is that the FDA and regulatory is going to require testing. So I like talking about companies that already have places in testing. Waters Company, I believe they're out of Boston, Massachusetts. They do a lot of testing and a lot of extraction. So they do the extraction from the plant, and they also do testing in terms of purity, and then also looking at kind of heavy metals or any contaminants that may be in the process. But as this becomes more of a mainstream play, you're going to see a lot more regulation, and you're going to see a lot of these companies relying on these other companies, a lot of these mainstream companies, mainstream cannabis hemp companies that are going to be relying on testing to be done because they're going to have to be compliant. Because once something goes mainstream, here comes the federal government. And they're a little late to the party usually, but when they get there, they do kind of come with the hammer.
Mm. So let me get your opinion. And unfortunately, we're going to run out of time. So we'll tease the audience with it, but they'll have to tune back in next week where we do some analysis. But, you know, you really got me thinking about the regulatory side. And what really got my attention when we talked last week was I didn't realize that a U.S. company, if they're selling marijuana, they can't actually be listed on TSX, NASDAQ, or NYSE. So, you know, everyone who's out there who's curious, you know, hey, I want to invest in an American pot grower. Well, you can't, because if you're an American pot grower, you can't be publicly listed because it's, you know, to put it bluntly, it's just not allowed right now.
Right.
Now, I saw a very interesting opportunity where literally they're called a special purpose, they're called SPAC, Special Purpose Acquisition Companies. They're called blank check companies. Have you heard of those before?
No.
Okay, so let me see if I can Google what this is called. It's called a blank check company.
Okay. I'm with you Googling too.
Okay. So I found the other day, hold on, let me see. Do you see my, wrong screen. Sharing the wrong screen. Let's go here. A SPAC is called a blank check company. Mm-hmm. And the purpose of a blank check company is to list yourself publicly and get that shell in place so that when the company is going to go public, they can kind of, I guess, do the end, or I don't want to say do the end around the SEC because that's clearly illegal, but it's essentially kind of a backdoor.
Well, that's what they, so it's interesting that you talk about this. I think we briefly hit the RTOs, which are the reverse takeovers. It seems very similar to what's been going on, and kind of, it just seems that that's pretty much the way cannabis companies in the United States have been functioning. So it's very, what I mean is very similar to the RTO is that they'll take a shell company in Canada or a company that they can basically take over in Canada that's already listed and already traded, and then they'll kind of basically take that company over, and then their company, which is this cannabis, United States cannabis company, now is a Canadian traded company. So that's what they did. I believe Green Growth Brands did that in late 2018. So they took over like a Shell oil and gas company. Now, again, they can be traded on the Toronto Stock Exchange, but they're traded on this, the Canadian Securities Exchange. So it sounds very similar to kind of what these blank check companies are doing. So if that makes sense.
Yeah, so I'm not gonna spring this on you this time because obviously, literally, like I found this out, we were looking in this and we found this, I think a day or two ago, one of our researchers showed me this and I was just like, this is awesome. But for people who are tuning in, well, first let's see, let's get, you know, the comments. If you're on, do you want to look at this? Because what I want to discuss with Courtney is I have found, or not me, but I've been made aware through our team that there is a blank check U.S. company that has been specifically created for listing cannabis acquisitions. So it's a blank check company, and it's just been kind of sitting there under the radar screen. And literally, they made an announcement about 2 months ago that, I think it was two and a half months ago, that there is a reverse merger coming through with a, call it picks and shovel type cannabis play that's gonna occur. Wow. And their pricing right now, because it hasn't become wildly known, their pricing is still at, call it acquisition cost in terms of what the deal terms are. It's not at these like inflated valuations. And I'm teasing you a little bit because obviously I don't want to put you on the spot because you haven't done this research, but I'm going to give you the information. I think I'd really love to have a detailed discussion about this next week when we come on, because I really want to look at the deal. Like, honestly, like I'm looking at this thing and it's awesome.
Yeah, I'm excited too. I'm like, oh, really? Interesting. I'm super.
It's pretty cool. Like, it's pretty cool. Like, well, I mean, like, let's look at it, right? You know, in terms of what cannabis companies have gone out, right? The big one we see is Tilray.
Yeah.
So let's look at Tilray. And I'm not saying Tilray is a good or a bad company, but honestly, I'm not gonna hop on Tilray right now.
I agree.
I don't know what you would do. I mean, it's like.
That's
buying when everyone else is saying, hey, you know, let's buy, you know, heck, I was on an Uber and my Uber driver was saying, hey, you know, we got talking, I do cannabis stuff, saying, hey, you know, Tilray, I bought some Tilray. I'm like, you know, I'm a little iffy on that when the Uber drivers.
I agree. But that's, you know what, Peter Lynch has said that too. He said, when everybody starts talking about, they start telling him about stock tips, he's like, oh, there's about to be a problem. And he says that in his, I think he says it in One Up on Wall Street. I thought that was really interesting that you said that.
Because it's great. But like, we look at Tilray, right? Tilray has what, 20 million in revenue, or what, 10 million a quarter? So they're on track for 40 million. And the company right now is worth $7.3 billion. Mm-hmm. So if you just do the math, that's like what? I don't even know what the price to revenue multiple, like that's ludicrous. That's just crazy, right? Now this company, their current market capitalization is, it comes out to, it basically will come out to when the deal is done and at the buy-in price, mm-hmm. the market cap, it's going to be a SaaS company. So this is a software as a service company that services the cannabis space. And the market cap on that company is going to be, I think, 6 or 7 times annual revenue.
Okay.
So if you look like, you know, I'm teasing all this sort of stuff. If you look at software company valuations, mm-hmm. just in general, let me throw out like, you know, Salesforce.com, you know, because they're the big leaders. If we look at, you know, technology, software as a service companies. Salesforce.com with $110 billion market cap trades against, you know, 10 to 1 in terms of, or it's 11 to 1 in terms of price to revenue. And I'm not saying Salesforce.com doesn't have growth potential, because it's a great company. And, you know, it's actually in my portfolio, because I also do, you know, other things. I don't just have all my money in like cannabis and crypto. But like, this is considered like more of a mature type valuation with a little bit of upside, you know, that might be slightly overvalued, because, you know, Salesforce.com in the world of software is killing it. Mm-hmm. So this company actually is at a lower valuation multiple of Salesforce. When they go public, it's going to be very well capitalized. So it'll have about $60 million in cash in the checking account for acquisitions. And it's in the cannabis space.
I'm very excited.
It's going to be pretty cool. So I think it's about time to wrap up part one, you know, how to invest $1,000 and turn it into big dollars and create generational wealth. Everyone who's tuned in, thanks for tuning in. This is going to become more of a regular show. Last week, I know we just popped on at a weird time, and this time we popped on, but we had some technical difficulties. So I apologize for the delay. But it'll be Tuesdays at 3 o'clock Eastern, 2 o'clock Central. And next week we'll be back and we'll get into this company that we're talking about. This should be pretty exciting.
I am excited. I am very excited.
All righty. Well, guys, hold on. Let me just stop the share. Thanks a lot for tuning in. And we will be back next week. Talk to you guys later.
Today. And you know why? Because we have the world's greatest female athlete, Jackie Joyner Kersee, and then right here from East St. Louis, Illinois.
DJ Nothing Nice introducing Junior Boy off of that non-stop grind record with his hit single, Oh. You already know DJ's on the man, his family, man. It's your boy DJ Nothing Nice. Let's go.
Project Outreach is a training and development 501c3 organization that specifically works with veterans, aging out youth, and justice-involved individuals. The program reduces homelessness, recidivism, and crime by offering...